Welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure to have you all here for our communication strategy session. And this is looking to be a very interesting session. We should have a nice range of talks looking at how different countries have responded, looking at how all sorts of aspects of the pandemic, from vaccine hesitancy to individual actions, can be communicated effectively to the public. We have a wonderful lineup of speakers today, and so it's my pleasure to welcome you all here. And to start off, it is my great pleasure to welcome Naftali Bennett, who is the former Israeli Minister of Defense, the leader of the Yamina party, and who is going to be presenting today a roadmap to zero COVID Israel. So it is my absolute pleasure, and please, thank you all.
Thank you very much, everyone, and it's indeed a pleasure to be here. Back in February and March, I served as Defense Minister of Israel, and effectively, I was responsible for the execution of the national plan. Back then, the immediate steps we took were to bring in rapid testing in good numbers and to build very attractive hotels, five-star hotels, actually, literally, in order to isolate the infected folks over there. It was vital from our perspective for the hotels to be incredibly attractive because it was pretty tough to get people, to persuade people to go. Israel, as you know, is a very vibrant democracy. We've got ultra-Orthodox groups, we've got Arabs, we've got secular Jews, we've got the whole gambit. So, you know, it's not a central command center where everyone just does what you tell them. You have to persuade them. And indeed, at the beginning, it was so fun to be at those hotels that it was tough at the end of the 14 or 20 day quarantine to get people to go home. Later on, it went down. I've been in opposition since May, and we are now in the midst of the third wave, very, very high infection rates, and we've got all the variations, all the mutations here in Israel. What makes Israel, and I have to say, from my perspective, there's a mean, it's sort of loss of control. However, at the same time, we are by far the most advanced nation in terms of the percentage of folks who are vaccinated, and a very impressive national effort of vaccinations, and it's going very well. In terms of the public cooperation, there was a bit of hesitancy at the beginning, but all the leaders of the country were the first to get vaccinated. There was a very good around the vaccinations and a feeling that it'll get us out of the cold. And that brings us to the point we are right now, which we're at very critical days now. Something happened about a week ago. We were in our third national lockdown. It's the third, and I think a few countries are at their third national lockdown, which obviously the public is already wary of all of this, is tired, is fed up. And there was a lot of enthusiasm that the vaccinations are the silver bullet, and we're just about to be in paradise, and how great it is. And I think that I am proud that we're very advanced. But what's happening now is there's a beginning of realizations that the vaccinations are not necessarily the silver bullet, not that we're against vaccinations, but relying exclusively on vaccinations could be a huge problem for a few different reasons. First of all, by definition of the 16-year-old and up limit, of Israel's population is under the age of 16, which means that we've got about 2.5 million people who will not be vaccinated for the next few months, as well as pregnant women. At any given time, there's roughly 150,000 Israeli women who are pregnant. And so they have no protection, and at very, even assuming that there's no extra lethality of the variations, just by the sheer, if you let go of everything and just depend on the vaccinations, you're gonna see very high infection rates and big numbers, very big numbers multiplied by a relatively small percentage means lots of very sick young people, or God forbid, dead young people, and pregnant women. And we're seeing over the past 10 days a very meaningful rise. The second thing is that there's growing realization that ultimately, at some point, there's going to be variations that will bypass the vaccinations. And in that sense, I have to say something that I'm not sure anyone talked about this, but Israel has become de facto, I'm not a professor, but I have common sense. So we went forward with this national vaccination operation, not when numbers were low, but while numbers are high, which means that we are vaccinating tens of thousands of people. We're vaccinating millions of people, but at least tens of thousands of people who are currently infected and we don't know it, because we don't do any PCR prior to the vaccination. We don't check. And you know, I assume my common sense, and we're seeing it, is that lots of people who are infected are getting vaccinated. And that turns Israel, so when you have a mix of massive vaccination and massive infection at the same time, effectively you're potentially creating evolutionary pressure and telling the mutations, come on, work harder to bypass these vaccinations. So I'm not, I've got no idea what the chances are they will or when that'll happen. I can't say whether it's 5% over the next year or 50% or 80% chance. But given what we've seen over the past couple, with the reduced effectiveness of the, pardon, I'm not sick, the South African variant, we're playing a fairly risky game. In Israel, there's 10 million people, and Israel is a very small country. All of this brings me to rethink the notion of just cleaning up Israel from COVID altogether. Well, it's lucky that we're on Zoom. I think lots of folks around the world thought that we can live with Corona. I'm not sure that's the case anymore. And I think that relying exclusively on the vaccinations is a mistake, especially given that Israel, while geographically it's not an island state, or topographically we're not surrounded by water, but effectively we are an island state. We've got we have borders with enemies or countries that there's barely any any movement when no one comes, enters, or exits Israel from Lebanon or Syria. And we've got Jordan and Egypt, which are a very low movement. So effectively, we've got one central international airport, and it's darn easy to control it. Unfortunately, we did not, over the past year, control it. And we let in, without any testing, pretty much all the variants, all the crud from all around the world. So Israel is going to be very interesting over the next few months, seeing what happens when the vaccinations meet all these variations. What we're ultimately going to need to do is, and I say ASAP, control the borders, i.e. Triple tests, 72 hours before flying. I see, upon landing and then a few days later, while being in a special hotel. And secondly, building areas or defining different areas within Israel and starting to clean it up one area after another with massive testing. A lot of work in persuading the public to keep up the work. Now, I've been asked a few questions. Is Israel using Pfizer or Moderna vaccine or both? We're using almost exclusively right now Pfizer. And we're seeing indeed a bit of a slowdown on the older people who have already administered the vaccine. But as I said, something has gone wrong over the past couple of weeks. Second question is, how was Israel so good at getting and administrating the vaccines? We our prime minister was very busy pitching Pfizer to let us buy it, and we bought it at high prices, but I support that. But we also, in terms of administering it, we our medical system is based on community providers that everyone gets. It's global. Everyone in Israel, whether they can afford it or not, have universal healthcare provided by four providers, and you can choose any. So there's effectively a four-way competition, which makes them very, very effective. So they're the folks who are executing it, and it's going very well. Derek is asking, do we know if other variants are circulating in Israel? So yeah, UK, South Africa, and Brazil are in Israel. UK is the prevalent right now. More than 50% of the public, of the infected folks, have the UK variant. Right now, we're at about 10% positive rate, so it's very difficult. We have a huge difficulty with the ultra-Orthodox folks who are not willing to stop the education system because of a value of learning Torah, and at the same time, it's very hard to enforce. What are you going to do? Come in with tanks or massive police? So it's quite an issue. If anyone has any further questions, I'd certainly be happy to respond. Let me take a look here. One moment. So what is the total population? I talked to it. So I think I've answered most of the questions. Will Israel vaccinate Palestinians? So we don't govern the Palestinians. The Palestinian authority does that, but we have been passing over vaccinations to the Palestinians, and you know, we view ourselves as one geographical cell. And I have to say they've been doing a very fair job in doing it. We have a very young population here in Israel. Our median is the age of 30, which is very fortunate. Justin Lee is asking on the early results of the very successful vaccination program. You mentioned something went wrong in the past couple of weeks. Can you extrapolate? So it's pretty early, and so I want to be very careful because unfortunately there's not been enough. First of all, I'm in the opposition, right? So we've got elections coming up in about a month and a half. Israel is a place that we always have elections, but we have seen a decrease in folks getting sick after achieving full immunity from the vaccine, definitely. I don't know if it's 95%, but it's clear and it works in that sense. We don't have indication of the effect on getting infected. We've got no information yet. And what we've not done, unfortunately, we're not doing outreach and random polls checking whether people are positive or negative. This is also something that I've been pushing for, but we don't yet, so I don't know. Now, what's happened over the past 10 days is suddenly we're in a national lockdown. It's always worked, and the R has been going down, but suddenly it stopped going down, and we don't know what's going on. It may be the variants that are fighting stronger than the lockdown and the vaccinations together. Israel, as James Sue has asked, does Israel have the California variant? To my best of knowledge, yes. Not in massive numbers, but yes. I think, what's your plan in protecting pregnant women without diving into a feminist we currently don't have a reasonable plan. Israel does not have a plan how to protect pregnant women. We're planless at that right now. What I would do in the immediate term, I would just say stay home, and I would provide for any support and compensation, and when we reopen the education system, I would ask them to not send their other kids to school until we get clarity on the ability to vaccinate them. That's what I would do if my wife was pregnant. I've got four kids. If she was pregnant, I would just say, I don't know about the country, but my home is going to be a zero COVID home. There's just no other option, and I would not take the risk. I think we're good. I think we're done.
Thank you very much. That was extremely informative and really, really interesting. So thank you all. And any continued questions, please continue to post them in the Slack, in the chat, and we will post them on the Slack channel and try to address them after the session. But thank you very much. So it is my pleasure to introduce Stephen Hassan, who is the founding director of the Freedom of Mind Resource Center, one of the world's leading cult experts, and is going to be talking to us today about a cult expert's advice on dealing with anti-vaxxers and general vaccine hesitancy. It's a pleasure to have you on today.
Thank you so much. It's an honor. to be part of this prestigious conference. And I just want to correct, my last name is pronounced Hassan, and I am actually Jewish, even though most people think I am not. And I have a very different take than most participants at the conference. I'm very honored that I was invited to come. So this is a cult expert's advice on dealing with anti-vaxxers and general vaccine hesitancy. And I want to start out by just saying that for me, we do not live in a post-truth world, even though the media keeps amplifying that incorrect message. We still live in a world of truth and facts and science. And it's my position is we live in an age of influence. And currently, we have been lacking the scientific tools to clearly define ethical and unethical influence in the law. PSYOPs, psychological operations, which include fourth generation warfare, which quickly to describe it, it was first written about by an American military strategist, William Lind, and then picked up with Paul Weyrich of the Christian Right. But it's basically psychological warfare to disorient the target population, delegitimize experts, leaders, institutions, confuse, overwhelm, create conflict. And what I see is a war happening using psychology, using state actors such as Russia, Iran, China, as well as cults like ISIS. And many other authoritarian cult groups. So this is one for me, one of the biggest areas of contribution I want to make in this presentation. And then I just wanted to mention social media is, as we know, there's been some deplatforming, but it's really missing the tools. My next slide is to just put out there for those who are not aware of it, but the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostics, the Statistical Manual, or the DSM-5, has actual category for brainwashing, thought reform of cults and terror organizations, and they talk about it in terms of disorienting people's identity. So for the public, what I'm saying is this is a thing. There's a huge public health issue here that has not been clearly identified or researched to see, but it's huge. And I just want to say simplistically, but it's very important in terms of how to influence people in an ethical way, to think about it as kind of the authentic person and the cult person. Because if there's a radical personality change, that person, who the person was previously, is still there and is very, it's very doable to elicit them and empower them. And for those people born into authoritarian cults and even authoritarian families, people still have, it's an incredible thing, but people want to know the truth. They don't like to be exploited. They want love, they want respect. So there's a lot to do. And part of my work as a mental health expert is to do recovery work with ex-members of cults as well as coach family members. How did I get into such a weird field? Well, 1974, when I was 19, I got deceptively recruited into the Moonies cult. And I went and had a radical personality change and turned my back on all of my values and wanted to take over the world and was programmed to believe that democracy was satanic and thought that God wanted Richard Nixon to be president during Watergate and even fasted because Moon ordered us to do so. And most young people have no idea what the Moonies are. They're best known for these mass weddings. I think the record is 30,000 couples where Moon would just say you and you, you and you, and you had 5 minutes to decide. So that's how I got interested. So I've been doing this full time for 45 years since my deprogramming out of that cult in 1976. I wanted to share the influence continuum. I think of all of my slides, this is the most important one. And it's a way of organizing ethical and unethical influence. And I think this is a major tool that the public needs to understand, that healthy groups that respect democracy and human rights practice informed consent. I put it down here for organizations. When, the way they recruit, you know what you're getting into, you know what the beliefs are, and your conscience, your compassion, your creativity, your critical thinking is encouraged. It's very love-based. Whereas destructive cults use deceptive recruitment and hate and manipulation, and they want dependency and obedience. So I'm going to move on in the interest of time, but this is up on the website. I'm going to share the slides as well. But people need to have a framework to separate ethical from unethical influence. And I, one of the things that helped me the most get deprogrammed in 76 was learning about brainwashing and thought reform from the 50s from Chinese communist researchers. And I've reorganized Festinger's cognitive dissonance theory and added information control. But I posit, and this is the subject of my doctoral dissertation, which just was recently published, and I'm just going to read it, the BITE model of authoritarian control. I did a quantitative study on 1,044 respondents, and we came up with extremely high significance as a factor of authoritarian control. And I attempt to pull together all of these constructs in relationship to the justice system in order to be able to help judges and juries and the public understand the differences between being lied to and facts and truth. What I've developed over the decades of helping people is what I call a strategic interactive approach. And this is, and I credit Dr. Baryam for teaching me complex systems starting in the 80s. Basically educating agents, family members, friends, ex-members, media, clergy, therapists, media, etc., to organize them to do an ethical influence program to undo the unethical influence. And what this is all about is empowering people to think for themselves and make their own decisions rather than look outside themselves to some other human or to some institution that will tell them what reality is. And I have a lot of concrete suggestions for how to interact with individuals with the goal of getting them to think. And the most powerful technique, drum roll, is asking a very good question in a respectful, thoughtful way and being quiet and waiting for an answer and doing the follow-up, because it's my thesis. If you take the frame of, well, if it's true, then it will stand up to scrutiny. And if you're right, then I need to adopt your point of view, and if it isn't right, then why would either of us want to follow that? So it's a very effective frame. So what I'm advocating actually in the fight to support science and facts and critical thinking is to think about what's been happening in the world as agents who've been deliberately inculcating magical thinking and anti-science and anti-expert thinking. And the idea is to empower people online in their communities and to begin an education, a psychoeducational approach. So this is different than what the way people normally speak to people involved with cult groups, because usually people try to argue with them and give them facts, which just makes them further, makes them go deeper and often alienates them. This is about building rapport and trust, gathering information, really listening carefully. And of course, finding the right person to influence someone, the right time and the right context makes a huge difference. And I mentioned Robert Kennedy. His family has written publicly that he's really off about anti-vaccination. But as far as I know, no one's doing anything to see if we can try to help him consider evidence and reevaluate, because if he changes his position, I think it could help a lot of people. And lastly, because I know I'm running out of time, so I talked about the BITE model. I did not go into all the components of the BITE model: behavior control, information control, thought control, and emotional control. All of these are on my slides on my Freedom of Mind website. But of the four, emotional control, one of the universal mind control techniques of destructive cults is phobias. And I've developed a three-step phobia intervention where I basically first start with people and explain that we feel fear in order to protect ourselves from danger. And if we need to be able to use our frontal cortex to identify, is there real danger or is there believed danger? And so I often start with something very benign like an elevator phobia or a phobia of dogs. And I talk about how if someone has a phobia, they have a movie in their head of something terrible happening with elevators. It's plummeting to their death or being trapped forever. And they have the internal dialogue that is, I'm stuck in an elevator. And they often will hold their breath or breathe very shallowly, rapidly. So there's a cascading effect in people to make them afraid of the stimuli, the elevator, and so they won't go into an elevator. And teaching people that you need to discern structural elevators that have integrity, that have been inspected, that have emergency brakes, where you have a phone. It's impossible to plummet and it's impossible to be stuck for eternity. And then I teach them a visualization exercise of imagining going into an elevator, riding safely and comfortably, changing the internal dialogue, and undoing the fear by deep breathing and what's called systematic desensitization. Why I'm going into this is because it's not that hard to teach. And once people understand that phobias are curable, and often not taking many, many sessions and teaching people to A, decide is there real danger or not, and then how to systematically intervene. Then I talk about how other cults, not the one the person's in, installs fears of talking to critics and former members, fears of leaving. And they will agree, oh, that's awful and that's ridiculous and that's a phobia. And then we come back to their group and what their thoughts is and whether or not they think it's possible to leave and be happy and fulfilled. I see I'm running out of time almost. So I have a lot of resources on my website, Freedom of Mind. I have a nonprofit, Freedom from Undue Influence, where I'm doing further research. And I believe that epidemiological public health research is absolutely vital. And we need to educate everyone about the mind and ethical and unethical influence. And that's my presentation. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So if anybody has any questions, please post them in the chat. So the first question is, anti-vaxxers and conspiracy theorists online, what is your suggestion about how to respond to them?
So I have a lot of blogs and a lot of advice, but basically don't argue, don't be angry with them, don't call them names. And ideally, if you know the person, then you re-access your relationship with the person before they got into this. Oh, and I wanted to say that there's a real difference between, that's my 15 minute timer, then I'm done. There's a real difference from people who've taken vaccinations but just fear the COVID one versus people who've always been fearful of it. It's going to require a different strategic approach. But basically, the idea is to teach what brainwashing is. Now, most anti-vaxxers believe people like me are brainwashed. I'm brainwashed by the liberal media, etc. So creating a frame of, oh, you think I'm brainwashing, tell me what your understanding of it is. And then I go into what the scholars who've studied brainwashing and their models. And I, so it's a step-by-step interactional thing. But again, the strategy that really works isn't attacking the leader, the doctrine, or the group straight on. It's really about describing it over here with something else, getting their understanding and agreement. Maybe they've heard of Nexium. Maybe they know about Jim Jones and the People's Temple. Talking about another group and how it works, and then kind of backing your way into wanting to be free, wanting to think for yourself, and not just blindly following an authority figure. I also want to just jump in and say, for religious groups, Abrahamic faiths, that say, you know, we can't have people studying science. The Israeli politician was talking about the ultra-Orthodox not necessarily supporting science and such. My position is, however you understand God and the Abrahamic faiths, God did not make human beings robots or clones. And the idea of us asking questions is endemic to the faith traditions. So I think I talked too long on that one question.
No problem. Thank you. So the next question is, what about a healthy skepticism of experts? So a lot of them have been very wrong about their predictions about the spread of COVID. And some of them, but not a lot, have admitted their, you know, that they were wrong. So is a certain level of distrust justified?
Yes.
And how does that affect the what you're discussing?
Yeah, no, if people have skepticism or questions, you never want to say, oh, don't be silly, trust them, they know what they're doing. The beauty about the scientific approach is that we don't have a truth with a capital T. We have a hypothesis, we do experimentation, and we have a community of a fellow scientists to reality test, and we're quick to abandon a hypothesis if it proves to be a false one. So really a humble attitude of scholars is necessary, and people who really know their stuff will say, you know, I don't have all the answers, but here's what we know so far. We need to gather more data, and we need to figure out a strategy that makes sense.
Thank you. So we have time for about one more question here. And so one other question is, you know, how do you do this? How do you connect directly with people, with patients, with families? You know, when we think about this sort of at scale in a country level, you know, how do you do this? How do you facilitate that right person at the right time in the right context?
So honestly, I've been doing this work for 45 years, but mostly for individual families who have a loved one, or for a group of ex-members of a particular group. So I need help. What I do know is we need massive education of mental health professionals, of the media, of law enforcement, of politicians. What I'm proposing really is a paradigm shift, because the law does not understand undue influence in a practical, applicable way, and it needs to. It's a desperate need right now. And as far as all of my experience and research, I've done the first scientific study to try to pull all these constructs together and to provide a formula for a judge and jury to evaluate the influencee, the influencer, and the methods used to manipulate and indoctrinate them. But we have a lot of work to do, and it sure would help to do a top-down and a bottom-up complex system approach. And so I had the audacity of suggesting that Congress invite me and my colleagues to talk about undue influence, brainwashing, and cults, and let everybody grill us, ask us questions, and present our models. because it might have a very positive effect everywhere.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk and a very interesting discussion. There are a lot of additional questions. Sorry, we're not able to get to everybody's questions, but we will post them in the Slack channel so that we can continue the discussion after this session has ended.
And can I just respond to one question? Prevention, right? Prevention, intervention, recovery, right? Public health. Like, we need to educate young people, because in an hour or two, we can preventively educate. It will take many, many, many more days, weeks, months, years to help someone once they're in the rabbit hole.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure having you on. Thank you. So for our next talk, it's a pleasure to introduce Matthew Wellington, who's the Director of Public Health Campaigns at the U.S. Public Interest Research Group. And this group has been a very strong advocate of this idea of starting over, doing it right in terms of our public health responses, advocating for increased testing, and really facilitating community communication and community engagement. And it's a pleasure to have you on, Matthew. Thank you.
Yeah, and thank you so much for inviting me. I think those last two talks were really interesting, and I'm excited to follow up on those. So I'm going to share my screen and get my slides up for all of you. So just give me one sec while I do that. Okay. Can folks see the slides?
Looks good.
Good. Awesome. I'm actually going to set my own timer as well, following from Mr. Hassan there. Okay. So yeah, thanks for that introduction, Jeremy, and thanks again for inviting me. I wanted to give a quick background on US PIRG and how we fit into, you know, not just public health, well, not just COVID, but public health issues in general, because I think it's going to inform this discussion. And then the topic that I wanted to address here, you know, as I was thinking through the talk, really ended up being using communications and media and visibility as an advocacy tool. So your audience being decision makers who really hold the power to curb the spread of this virus through the interventions that they choose to take, or on the flip side, choose not to take and let the virus run rampant throughout our communities. And so a little bit more of my background. So I'm the Public Health Campaigns Director for US PIRG. We are a national consumer advocacy group, and we've got a presence in DC and a state presence in about half the states across the country. So we do have the ability to influence policy at a lot of different levels, which I think is part of what we bring to the table on some of these issues. So we can you know, hold governors accountable. We can work in towns, cities all across the country, and of course in DC. And you know, I think the role we play in COVID-19 and in public health issues in general is basically being a bridge between public health experts, decision makers, and the public. So I can say, you know, I'm not an infectious disease expert. I'm not a physician. I'm a political advocate. I've been organizing for, you know, political change and policies that will protect our health for the last, you know, 8 years. So that's where I come into this. I partner with public health experts to make sure that we're breaking down pretty complex scientific medical issues in a way that people will immediately understand, and that will get their kind of heads nodding and hearts pumping, is the way I like to think about it. And that goes for our decision makers as well, our elected officials. So trying to figure out what are the right messengers for them? How do we pressure them? How do we influence them to make the right decisions for public health? So that's what I'm going to talk about. And I'm mostly just going to use some examples from this past year about how we've tried to do this, sometimes successfully, sometimes not, with our COVID-19 response efforts. So the first thing I wanted to dig into is a letter that we organized last summer. This was right at the peak of, you know, the second virus surge in the United States. And I had been talking to public health professionals all over the country about what they thought we needed to do to get out of this mess. And many of them were saying the same thing to me. And that was, number one, we didn't shut down the first time properly. We didn't use the time that first shutdown in a lot of states should have given us to stand up a proper response. So things like ramping up testing, making sure we were educating people about the importance of mask wearing, we didn't do that. And so we really just needed to hit the reset button back in the summer. But there were very few public health professionals who were kind of screaming this message from the rooftops. And I think that's because it's not a really popular one. You know, I mean, I think people coming out of the spring in the US, they had, you know, just started to lift some of the restrictions into the summer. Nobody wanted to hear that we needed to go back into a shutdown. And so we decided we were gonna kind of plant a flag in the ground and organize some strength in numbers from health professionals all over the US saying the same clear, concise public health message for our decision makers. And that is shut down, start over, and do it right. So I don't have the full letter here, but folks can go to USPIRG's website and check it out. If they just search USPIRG.org and you look at our shutdown letter, that should just pop right up if you search it. But basically, this was the message that I have underneath here. The best thing for the nation is not to reopen as quickly as possible. It's to save as many lives as possible. And we made the conscious choice to make this very kind of action-oriented, or, you know, it was an open letter to America's decision makers. So that was the audience. It was elected officials at every level of government. We addressed it to state governors. We addressed it to Congress. We addressed it to the Trump administration back then. And throughout the whole letter, it's all about how we know exactly what we need to do to save lives and stop this virus from, you know, surging throughout our communities. It's just a matter of our elected officials stepping up and doing it, you know? So that was the main idea. Make it all about the agency. We know what we have to do to save lives, and then pressure our elected officials to, you know, make the hard decision that will ultimately save thousands of lives, right? And so we decided strength in numbers is going to be key. Our initial outreach to health professionals across the country was really positive. We ended up getting 150 signers from all different backgrounds in the health community, epidemiologists, you know, virologists, you name it, saying the same thing, you know, thank you so much for organizing this. And that was only in like 2 days. By the time we released it to the media, and I'll show more examples of some of the visibility we got, we had ended with nearly 1,500 health professionals from every single state in the country signing onto this letter. So I'll give you some examples of how this played out. So obviously one piece of impact that we used this letter for was influencing decision makers directly. So we sent this directly to governor's offices. We sent it to, in all 50 states. We sent it to leadership in Congress. We sent it to the Trump administration. But really, we wanted to use this as a visibility tactic. So we released this to the media initially just when we had the 150 signers, and then we re-released it about two or three times as we got more and more signers to show that this was a building movement. And it was picked up by, I would say, almost every major national news outlet, certainly hundreds of local and state media outlets picked this up, and we're talking about what it means for their states. Governors all across the country started to get questions from reporters about this letter. One in particular stuck out to me. It was in Texas. This was right around the time where Texas, you know, it was bad. It's bad right now, but it was bad in the summer as well. And the governor just kept saying over and over again, we're not shutting back down again. You know, we need to get our economy going. We're not shutting back down. Reporters started to ask him about this letter and ask him, you know, given how bad things are, there are, you know, more than 1,000 health professionals, including many here in Texas, who say this is what you need to do. So putting pressure on governors directly. And then, you know, this is another key part of the message here from this MSNBC clip. They actually put the letter still shot on the television for millions of people to see, which is great. Many of the actions of our government thus far have fallen short of what the moment demands. Mr. Trump, federal administration, honorable governors, we remind you that history has its eyes on you. So again, the audience here is squarely focused on our decision makers. And then the other key part of what we did was partnering with some of the most credible messengers on this issue, right? So frontline workers, people who are caring for patients, COVID patients in the hospitals, who have seen how bad it had gotten, who were worried how bad it was gonna get. And this is just one of them, Dr. Seth Truger, who's an emergency medicine physician out of Chicago. He was on CNN. We actually created a speakers bureau of about 25 health professionals who said, yes, put me on the, you know, put me in the media. I want to be putting this message out there. And that got a ton of coverage. This is just another example from NPR. So really broad media visibility. And again, that really, I think, put an intense amount of pressure on governors specifically to, number one, not reopen so quickly, because that was what was happening at the time. Governors were just racing to reopen their states as fast as possible because they were under immense amounts of pressure from, you know, businesses and business associations, and that's totally understandable. And so part of what we wanted to do was create pressure from the other side on this to show that they have the choice to make here, and it's really about how many lives they're going to choose to save. And here's what health experts are saying. We know what we need to do. And then in terms of the, you know, what was the outcome of this effort, there were a few things. So I think the big idea here was obviously this was going to be a heavy lift, you know, getting our decision makers to shut back down again, unpopular, you know, that's an unpopular thing to do with their constituents. We knew that was a big ask, but we wanted to make the clearest and best ask for public health, understanding that it would leave room for other folks to come in and say, well, if you're not willing to do a full stay-at-home order or fully shut down again, here are at least a few of the things that you should do right now as well. And I think that really, opened up that door for governors to compromise in their own way. And it wasn't everything that we wanted. Not many states officially shut down again and followed all of our recommendations. But as I was going back in the, you know, end of the summer to look back on what kind of effect this letter had, several states had issued mask mandates, which was one of the recommendations in our letter. Since we delivered it to governors and got all that visibility, several states had issued mask mandates since then. Several states had either paused or even rolled back their reopening plans. So it certainly had an effect. And then this example here is probably the best one. So Hawaii, they were seeing an extreme surge in cases at the end of the summer. And we worked with Hawaii health professionals to resend the letter to the governor in Hawaii, and got some more media around that. And then like 4 or 5 days later, the governor came out saying, we're gonna, you know, have a stay at home order for the largest population section in Hawaii. And then it's no coincidence, I think, that now, you know, many months later, the governor had followed all these recommendations. They shut down, they ramped up testing, they, you know, made sure they educated people about mask wearing. Now Hawaii has some of the lowest daily case counts of any state in the country. So again, you know, we know these things will help save lives. It's just a matter of our leaders stepping up and doing it. So I'll just go really quickly, because I'm watching my time, through a couple other examples here. So part of what we think through in our communications is, who are the best messengers to reach decision makers in an effective way? And in the summer with the health professional letter, obviously the biggest response from governors was, no way can we shut down again. Like, we're not gonna be shutting down businesses. It's gonna tank our economy. And so that was a signal to me that, okay, well, we need to remove that political barrier now. So we did a very similar letter to the one that I just showed, but on behalf of some of the top economists across the country. It wasn't as big in terms of its scope, but we had, I think we ended with like 30 pretty prominent economists who said very clearly the same message. No, the economy is not gonna recover until you control this virus. And the best way to do that now, the quickest way to do it, is to shut down, ramp up testing, institute mask mandates, and then reopen only when case counts are so extremely low that you can catch any outbreaks before they happen with widespread testing. So not only the health professionals just screaming that message from the rooftops in the media and pressuring governors, but also the economists saying, no, you're wrong. You know, this is actually, there's no choice between public health and the economy. We know we're not going to get out of this mess until you control the virus. So do it. And this was actually a story from the front page of the Austin American Statesman, one of the key papers in Texas. And this was all, I don't know the full article here, but this is just the headline. So economist states economic outlook hinges on virus fight. So that was our key message. And the whole article was about our letter and quoted pretty extensively from it. And then Governor Abbott, you know, he did put a pause on some of his reopening plans throughout this time period. So again, we didn't get everything we wanted, not a full shutdown, but at least some progress. The other thing we have done the last several months, I think this started back in October, was issue a state-specific testing scorecard, because one of the communications tool for, you know, my advocacy is always breaking down issues in a simple way, not only for the media, but also for people to, you know, pretty quickly monitor and be able to hold their officials accountable. So we found this really great state-by-state model from the Brown School of Public Health that breaks down how much testing each state needs to do to effectively suppress the virus. And then it also has the actual amount of testing that those states are doing. We basically just use that metric, created a scorecard for what kind of progress states were getting towards that suppression level target, and then graded them just on a simple, you know, A through F grade scale, and released that to the media, and then sent that to governor's offices as well with recommendations for what other states had done to increase their grade. So again, it's all about being action oriented. You never want to, when you're using communications as a tool like this and you're pushing for policy, you never want to just come out and, you know, complain and say, oh my God, they're doing such a terrible job. You always want to have the solution there and give people agency, right? People want hope. They want to know that there's something we can do about it. And they want to know that if we do it, then we'll have a good shot at making things better. So this scorecard, we had, you know, pretty simple grade that we've been putting out. I think this is our third time putting it out. Actually, next week is the next version of it that's coming out. These are some of the press clips from it in California and in Pennsylvania, and it's led to some really good discussions with governor's offices directly about how we think they can ramp up testing, and again, how they can use other states as models who have done it better. And then my last example here, we also want to hold governors accountable if they do the wrong thing, right? So it goes both ways. You know, in our communications and our advocacy, if a governor does the right thing, we will immediately reach out to the press and issue a statement that is overwhelmingly positive, that is giving them all of the credit they deserve. And I should have put an example of that here because we have done it many times. You know, when governors do the right thing, we're quick to praise them. But when governors do the wrong thing, we're quick to hold them accountable. So this is a story from like 2 days ago. California, who is still, you know, in the midst of a pretty severe outbreak, the governor, you know, suddenly said, we're going to lift the regional stay-at-home orders. This is a bad idea. You know, they're nowhere near, cases are going down, but they're nowhere near the level that health professionals say they need to be to lift some of these restrictions. And so this is a quote from our state director out in California, Emily Rush, in the New York Times story about it. And this is a really key message, right? So we should not risk a backslide in the recent gains we've made against this virus just to allow people to go out to eat at a restaurant or get a haircut again. So this is another message we often use of like, you know, number one, keep the priorities what they should be, and that is saving lives. Number two, we know that if you reopen too quickly, it's going to lead to another surge, and you're just going to be dragging and prolonging the economic damage that we're seeing. And then three, you know, just make this super clear, like we should not be lifting restrictions at the smallest sign of progress for things that could risk lives, right? It doesn't make any sense. So I wouldn't be surprised if the governor, you know, regrets this decision pretty soon and ends up going back. And then the last thing I'll say is just some quick takeaways for communication and advocacy. And again, mostly using communications as an advocacy tool. So one is make the best ask for public health, right? So again, that's shooting for the moon and being okay if you land on a star. So we called for shutdowns. Instead, what we got was a rollback of some reopening, pausing on reopenings, more mask mandates, and that was good. Two is focus your message on what's at stake and what we can do about it. Again, this is all about being action oriented. Don't just complain. Partner with the most credible messenger. So again, you know, when we released that letter in the summer, I purposefully did not want to be the one in front of the cameras and talking to media about it. I wanted it to be the frontline medical professionals who are dealing with this stuff day in and day out. And then the same thing with the economists. So, you know, they say the economy is going to tank. Well, the economists that we've got on this letter say that is totally the wrong way to think about it. And then set goals for people. This is setting goals for the public to be able to monitor, you know, progress and also to hold decision makers accountable. So the scorecard I showed is an example of that on testing. And then the last thing is know your audience. So our audience for all of this, as I said, was decision makers, right? Using visibility communications as a way to pressure decision makers to do the right thing. It could have, you know, in some ways it's been more community oriented, like directly educating people. So just know your audience and then craft your communication strategies based on that. And I'm going to stop there. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's a really, I really like that perspective of, you know, shooting for the moon, but being able to realize that every step we take in that right direction helps. So thank you very much. So we have time for a couple questions, and we have one to begin with, which is that, you know, with the new variants here and on the horizon, what is your recommended messaging for the governors who insist that the economy and schools need to be fully open right now?
Right. So I guess I have two answers to that question. The first one about the economy. So this is something that we did put out in our media response to Governor Newsom's announcement. So we talked about the new variant, and we basically said, this is not the time to be, this is the time to double down, basically. It's not the time to retract restrictions. It's the time to double down. We know that this new variant, or I think we likely know this new variant is more contagious. It's going to easily spread. This is not the time to be lifting restrictions. We need to be doubling down on our public health messaging. Our leaders need to double down on the fact that, you know, again, we know what will save lives, and those are even more important now that we've got this new, more easily transmissible variant out there. So I think it's doubling down on some of the things that we've already been talking about for the last 10 months, right? It's just like added urgency. The schools thing is my second answer to that on schools. You know, our line on schools has always been, of course we want schools to be open, but we've never prioritized opening schools. You know, governors have always prioritized opening restaurants or opening other businesses, but they haven't prioritized opening schools. And so we know that we can open schools safely if we do all of the other things first, right? We got to shut down non-essential businesses, get folks to stay home, get the cases down to a manageable level or, you know, almost non-existent, have an aggressive testing and tracing strategy, and then we can open schools with the proper protocols, and that'll be a lot safer than what we're doing now. So that's our take on the schools.
Thank you. And one last question, and then any other questions, please continue to post them in the chat and we will transfer them to the Slack channel afterwards. But do you have any other scorecard type evaluations that are in the works?
Yeah, so, well, I mentioned we've got the third version of the testing scorecard next week. We also have a report that I think came out today, came out today. It's not a scorecard necessarily, but we have been releasing short reports about shortages in nursing homes, shortages for PPE, shortages for staffing. Obviously, nursing homes are where we're housing some of our most vulnerable populations, so we need to have added emphasis on protection there. And I think today we just released the latest version of that. So again, it's not a scorecard, but it is very concise, compelling. And if folks just search like nursing homes, US PIRG, I'm sure it'll pop up in Google.
Excellent. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure having you on.
Thanks.
So we are now going to take a 5-minute break, and we're going to come back at 11:15 Eastern time. So please stay tuned, and we will be back in just about 5 minutes. Thank you.